It's Wednesday, it's 7 o'clock, it's time for Magic TV. I'm Mashi Scanlon, the guy on the left. With me, Paul Cheon, Humph, Darksteel Humphrey, and I can't believe my eyes. It was pretty unbelievable when I saw you walk in here, behind the camera, the Burglar of Willis himself.
He's back.
It's been a long time since we've had the band together, I'll say that. I mean, you know, a lot of things have been going on, but it's been a while since I've seen you, Burglar. How have you been? Thumbs up, all right, that's good. Paul, yourself, how you doing?
I'm all right, all right.
And we got a lot of great things to cover on Magic TV this week. Of course, we had two GPs this last weekend. We had Pittsburgh and Taipei. We have the interesting visa issue for the Pro Tour. I'm not sure if many of you out there know what's going on there. Of course, Paul, you are intimately familiar with this since you plan on traveling to Pro Tour Eldrick Moon. We have a new bundle of joy, a Sarcedo Scott Vargas, who has just joined us, or... Did you say Scott Vargas Sarcedo? I think Sarcedo Scott Vargas
sounds better. It's Scott Vargas Sarcedo.
Sarcedo Scott Vargas sounds better, though, doesn't it?
Yeah, well.
I'm just saying it.
We'll talk about it in a little bit.
And then we have a bunch of preview cards from Eldritch Moon. There's new mechanics. There's a few preview cards. And we have this week's top eight. Before we get into all that, I want to remind you that Magic TV and our Magic TV top eights are brought to you by ChannelFireball.com. All of the cards we're going to talk about from Eldritch Moon should be available on the website right now. We are pre-selling the Eldrick Moon singles, and of course, you want to check out any of the sealed product that is also available for pre-sale. It's funny because it seems like Eternal Masters just came out and we're hitting Eldrick Moon, so if you're still looking for Eternal Masters products, sealed products, or singles, check that out on channelfireball.com. We'll take care of you. There's tons of stuff on the website right now. So,
Who prices these cards is like the moment they come out? It's crazy.
Tommy.
Yeah?
Yeah, Channel Fireball, Director of Sales and Marketing.
Because like
Tommy
you don't
Adams.
Exactly know how the standard decks are going to shape up, and you're just
they
like,
they change
oh.
a lot. They're very volatile.
So if you're good at speculating, you might be able to pick up
already
some.
I already have a pick. I think, I can tell you this right now, this is a weird one, but Emrakul. And it's at like $25. It's not like that's like a $5 card that's going to spike. I think Emrakul's around $25.
You think that's going to go up?
I think so. Do you think it's good?
I think it's good, but like Ulamog didn't. I don't know how expensive Ulamog ended up being, but... I don't really follow the economy, but
you think Ulamog's better than Emrakul?
No, but what I mean is like Ulamog was like similar type of card.
Well, no, now it doesn't matter. Is it going to settle down? Is it going to find a deck? Is it going to you know?
Well, yeah, no, it's definitely going to be in a deck. It's right. just like you know, it's a card that's going to be like a one or two of.
As every Eldrazi.
Right.
Well, no, I shouldn't say every Eldrazi Titan is.
Yeah.
You readily play more than one in any of the big.
Yeah, I mean it's a good card. I just don't you know I don't know. But I'm terrible at this kind of stuff. But I just don't.
Well, don't evaluate the value of the card just monetarily. Evaluate the value of the card. Like, do you think the new Emrakul is a good card?
Yes.
Like, will it see Type 2 play?
It will definitely see standard play.
Will it see modern play?
No.
Really?
You have the other Emrakul.
It's just too outclassed.
Yeah, the other Emrakul is just so much better.
Once
you get to modern, you're trying to cheat it into play, not cast it.
Yeah.
Standard's the only format where you're just like, all right, I got nine mana, I'm just going to play it, right? In modern, you don't have that kind of time.
Yeah. All right, well, we have plenty to talk about with Eldrick Moon, but before we get there, let's talk about this last weekend. It's weird. It's like Standard's like last hurrah.
It's funny how like Standard's kind of devolved into what it is now. Because when this set first came out, people were like, oh my god, Standard is so diverse.
The possibilities are wide open.
There's all these crazy decks. Mm-hmm. You know, you had the top eight of the Pro Tour have all these different archetypes. And then, now, this is where we're at, and it's kind of sad. This happens a lot, you know, people figure out what the best decks are. But then, like, people can figure out how to beat these decks.
Yeah.
That just hasn't been the case right now.
Well, it's weird. I think, was it Sigrist? Did he top eight with green-white tokens? Someone top eighted with green-white tokens.
Steve Rubin.
Rubin, sorry. Yeah. So it's been in the metagame since the very beginning, right? Since he won the Pro Tour with green-white tokens, right? And so it's like this weird thing where, you know, it kind of reminds you of Mono Blue Devotion in Theros Block, where, you know, it was in both Pro Tours that bookended, you know, like Theros Block being a thing. Green-white tokens, like right now, here's an honest question. This is an honest question for all of you, too. Okay, everyone watching, everyone who's grinding, everyone playing Standard. I don't know why I feel this way, but I kind of feel like we've just kind of given up and just green-white tokens is it.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's... I'm not saying there's a definite answer out there, but I... Look at these results.
They don't lie. I mean, it won Pittsburgh, and it just keeps putting up numbers, and there's just no real good way to attack this deck. There really isn't. If there was, people would have figured it out, and you'd see more people playing those other decks, but that it just doesn't exist.
And
there are other decks that are competitive against it. Mm-hmm. You have all these like Seasons Past decks with main deck Virulent Plague or whatever, or just trying to do all these different things going over the top, but those decks can stumble. The green-white deck is just so streamlined and still powerful. It's got a great early game and a great late game.
You know what's funny, though? And we should all take time to appreciate the fact that we're talking about how unbeatable green-white is in Standard right now.
I know. Why wasn't green-white this good when I played Hammer Time?
Nothing was going to save that deck. That deck was a pile.
You could play turn 3 Oversoul of Dusk. I'm just saying.
Oh, wow. Game over. What would you do against it? Turn 3 Oversoul of Dusk. Well, yeah. We'll probably just die.
Protection from blue and black. Isn't it so good against fairies?
So, your Oversouls of Dusk and Great Sable Stags. And
should have speculated on those.
Just get there. I got a lot I can sell you now if you
No,
if
I'm
you
good.
Want
I'm good now.
Sure?
No, it's a standard card. See, standard cards go down in value.
Down. No value modern.
Yeah.
Well, we all know what the problem is. We tried to tell you this 2 weeks ago on Magic TV. We tried to tell you Dromoka's Command was too OP. And what happens? 2 GPs in the same weekend out of 64 possible slots.
Yep.
The max number that you get in both top 8s is 64. 54 are played. 54 copies in both top, like combined in both top 8s.
That's just absurd. I don't know. Maybe Wizards just hates control decks. Because this is what it's saying, right? You have all these other just creature decks that are great. In those matchups, Dromoka's Command is fantastic. Dromoka's Command is terrible against a control deck. And there's just no good viable control decks. There's just not enough support for those decks. And that's why, you know, in a field where there's just no good control deck, Dromoka's Command is obviously just an amazing card.
Well, I want to be fair to Wizards of the Coast here. I don't think it's Wizards that dislikes control decks. I think it's players on a wide scale.
Players love control
players
decks.
Players do not love.
You
may love control
decks. No, there is a nice percentage of people that like to play control decks but just can't because it's just not very good right now. You know, there's a lot of people that like to play control decks.
What percent of players that play Magic, all players on kitchen tables everywhere,
right,
do you think like to play control?
I would say 10 to 20%.
Okay, fine. I think that's fair. Yeah. I think that's legit.
No, not like I'm saying half the people.
If you'd gone north of 20, I would have said no way.
Well, yeah, not only
and I think 20 is the outside.
Well, yeah, not only that, there's like no mono red deck either. 10 to 20% also like to play mono red.
Way higher.
Okay, 20 plus. Yeah. 20 plus percent like to play decks like mono red, but you know, you're stuck having to play like White Weenie, where Dromoka's Command, once again, is also just insane against that.
A bunch of BS. Wizards need to bring back Pillage. Thank you for making my point for me. If we had Pillage in the format, we'd have some decent mono-red stuff going on, right?
Yeah.
No, it is a testament. I mean, we've both spent plenty of time in different metagames where, like, green's the worst color or white's the worst color. Certainly green-white can be the worst color combination. So it's crazy to think about how we're in a metagame right now, standard right now, where we look at green-white, a green-white deck, a green-white creature deck. It's not control. It's not slide. It is a creature deck. Yeah, it can go into a more controlling phase with the planeswalkers. That's just dominant.
Last time a green-white deck was this dominant?
Slide.
Was it slide?
It might have been slide.
There had to have been something in between. But, I mean, it's been a really, really long time.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, it's not that often that a deck is this dominant.
Right.
Right? So it
reminds me of kind of like how oppressive or how insane Jund was in Standard back in the day, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just like Jund had all the best cards, and so everybody had to play it. Same thing. Green-white just has all the best cards. If you look, the deck is 90% rares, and all the rares are very good.
It's true. So is Sylvan Advocate now the best card in Standard? We talked about this before where, you know, Collected Company, we were saying probably the best card in Standard about a month ago.
Right.
Has that been replaced? Sylvan Advocate. There were, I mean, I didn't do a count on the Sylvan Advocates because I'm so focused on our banned Dromoka's Command strategy. But is Sylvan Advocate now the best card in Type 2?
No, it's probably Dromoka's Command.
Is it Dromoka's Command?
Well, Sylvan Advocate doesn't see play everywhere. Like, there are banned humans decks that don't play the Advocate. Advocate is a very, very good card. So is Tireless Tracker. There's a lot of decent cards that are up there. Collected Company is also obviously very, very strong. But if you're just talking about sheer dominance in terms of numbers, it has to be Dromoka's Command because it goes in both the banned deck and the green-white.
Well, here's the big difference between those two cards, though. In any given matchup, is Dromoka's Command going to stay in for all three games?
Well, I mean, if you want to go down that route, I would go with Collective Company over Sylvan Advocate.
Why? Because how often does Sylvan Advocate get cited out?
I don't know, but Collective Company is a far more powerful card. I'm a lot happier to have a Collective Company in my hand in my company decks than any random two drop. Because the thing with the company decks is all of your creatures are very, very good.
So take the reasoning you've applied to Collective Company and take the reasoning you've applied to Daroka's Command. Doesn't Sylvan Advocate fall into both those categories?
Well, Sylvan Advocate, once again, Sylvan Advocate.
It's in that sliver of the Venn diagram.
I mean, yes, Sylvan Advocate is very good. I'm not going to argue this.
Nobody's saying it's bad. It's just an interesting discussion. Like, what's the better card in Standard? I think there's an argument for Sylvan Advocate.
Sure.
And the only reason I bring that up is because you made a comment before we went live, like, yeah, Elvish Warrior's come a long way. Yes, it has. Like, what the heck? It's freaking 2-mana, 2/3 vigilance. Like, it's huge.
It's funny, too, because, like, when it first came out, it wasn't all over the place. You know, people were just like, oh, it's a 2-mana, 2/3 vigilance or whatever. Yeah. And, I mean, it didn't take too long. But now it's obviously everywhere, and you just have all these green decks. Even like the Seasons Pass decks are, you know, opting to play, you know, more creatures early to interact, and it's playing four Sylvan Advocates and Tireless Trackers as well. Mm-hmm. So yeah, there's a lot of insanely overpowered and efficient creatures in Standard right now, and I mean maybe that's what makes kind of control kind of hard to stick around too.
It's weird. You know, you mentioned Jund, and there have been other metagames. Like, the one I always think of is that sliver of time when, like, Urza's Slayer came out and, you know, Academy decks were everywhere. And you had to find a way to win. You had to find, like, that little chink in the armor. And it's not always successful. Like, in those days, you would play, I can't remember what it was, the remote isle, basically the new Phantasmal Terrain that turned cards into islands so that you could drop it on their Talarian Academy before they went off. And it was a fish deck, and you know,
Spreading Seas.
Yeah, it wasn't. It was Spreading Seas before Spreading Seas.
Sure.
And it's interesting because you try to find a way. Okay, how do we beat the deck? What's the chink in the armor? What can we go after? Right.
But it forces you to play bad cards.
It does, and it forces you to play bad decks. And you still, by the way, you still lost when you played fish against Academy. You were still like a coin flip at best, right? Yeah. You might as well just play Academy at that point. And what I find interesting is, I don't know where that little gap in the armor is for green-white tokens. Because it seems like it's been so... We talk about it every week. It's just the best card, the best deck in Standard.
Maybe they could have made some changes, make some emergency... for example, like, Hero's Downfall would be perfect. You know what I mean? Just to have an answer that allows you to deal with all the different angles of attack that deck has. You can kill the Gideon at instant speed. You can kill the Avacyn. Mm-hmm. You know, Ruinous Path is a great card, but it's pretty awkward against Avacyn.
Right.
So Hero's Downfall would be completely fine, and it would probably even just be balanced, given how popular and how good the green-white decks are. So, or even like a Pithing Needle. Pithing Needle would be pretty good against green-white as well.
Uh-huh.
Just a lot of different answers to Planeswalkers, because right now there aren't a whole lot of great options. You know, Anguish Unmaking is fine, but if the green-white deck randomly gets an aggressive draw, like, the three life is a big game as well.
It becomes huge.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a great deck. Did you see the Sultai deck that made the top eight?
I did. It's just another take on, you know, with the various Seasons Pass control decks. You have your green-black shell. You have your removal. Once again, you have your, like, your advocates or your trackers or what have you, or Nissa. And then you try to go over the top with Seasons Pass. You know, the issue that I've had with those decks a lot of times is sometimes you just get some really clunky draws, right?
Yeah.
Like, if your removal and your card draw all line up perfectly with the green-white deck, sure.
You're going
to
blow them out.
If you're at a high life total, yes. Once you resolve Seasons Pass, it's going to be hard to lose. But a lot of times that doesn't happen. Because, you know, sometimes you're going to have a Dark Petition in your hand. Sometimes you're going to have that Dragonlord Silumgar you can't cast for a while.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas the green-white deck is just so consistent.
Yeah.
Every single game is the exact same.
It's one of those things where when you stumble...
Yeah,
the green white's just going to overrun you.
Yeah, and sometimes they're just going to have Nissa Gideon, and you're going to have one downfall or one Ruinous Path, and you're still just going to lose to the other Planeswalker.
Mm-hmm.
There's just not a lot of great ways to kill Planeswalkers.
It was the Sultai deck, actually, that made me just kind of think about how good green white tokens is, because this is a deck that's clearly has green white tokens on the brain, right?
Right.
The deck is built to beat green white tokens, and despite that, despite the fact that it has one deck in its crosshairs, it still doesn't look, you know, like an amazing matchup. You know, normally you think, okay, if all I'm going to do is put all my effort into beating one deck, okay, I'm going to beat that deck. I'm going to get like a 70-75% win ratio against that deck. And that doesn't look like is the case. So, yeah, I mean, green-white tokens, dominant. Green-white in general, and Dromoka's Command specifically. As we warned you, that was like 2 weeks ago, right? As we warned you, should have been banned. No, I'm not saying that. But if you do play the numbers game, if you start looking at the numbers and think and looking at, you know, basing things like on, like that. I mean, that's what happened with Jace the Mind Sculptor and was it Ponder? There was like the full complement in the top eight, and that was the prelude to it being banned. It wasn't Ponder. It was Preordain. It was Jace the Mind Sculptor and Preordain. It was like 32 out of 32 in the top eight.
Yeah, that's when you know a format's not very healthy. Right now, it's Banton Green White, but it's it does share that one card.
Well, and it's interesting because it seems kind of self-evident with Jace and Preordain. And Jace, you know, there's definitely a problem there, but we talked about this already, so I don't want to get into it. The fact that Dromoka's Command's not a blue card, I think, is probably helping it, because you were seeing a lot of that card. Yeah. Like, a lot.
Yeah, the funny thing is, like, yeah, Dromoka's Command is very, very good. What's funny is, even if they banned Dromoka's Command, both of those decks would still just be very good. You have access to other removal spells. You can just play Declaration in Stone.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like the...
You don't think losing the enchantment removal would be big?
Well, you know what? That would definitely make the format... that would make the format a little better.
Yeah.
Because that would make it so that people could go back to playing Silk Wraps and Stasis Snare's main and have it not just...
That's the game breaker.
Because then, because then your control decks would actually be somewhat viable.
You could start running those cards. Whereas right now, you're like, forget it. You're just playing into it, right?
You're just like, no, I'm not going to play these enchantments because that's the one thing I have going for me is that your Dromoka's commands are not
good. I'm going to blank that mode.
Right.
I will say this. Props to Greater Chubtoad. Two of them in the Sultai deck. You'll get Gitrog Monster. So was very happy to see that. Your run in Standard's not over. Go get them, Chubs. Any other thoughts on Standard right now?
Looking forward to kind of how the new set is going to shake things up, but I am doubtful that those decks are not going to remain like the top two decks in Standard.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah. I think there might be a couple of other playable decks, but I mean, I just don't see how like the green-white deck is supposed to get worse. If anything, they've printed a few cards that might actually make it better.
You think we're seeing a Liliana and Eldritch Moon?
I have no idea.
She's all over the advertising for it.
Well, then I wouldn't be surprised.
She has to be in Eldritch Moon. Don't you think?
Yeah, you've seen all the other Planeswalkers, right?
Burglar, what do you think? Liliana in Eldritch Moon or not? Now someone in the chat's going to pop up and be like, yeah, they've already confirmed this in the storyline or something like that. I'm like, awkward. No.
I wouldn't be surprised.
Get some Liliana the Veil in there.
Yeah.
Huh? Liliana the Veil, Eldritch Moon. Boom. All right. That's it for Standard. Let's talk about this upcoming Pro Tour, speaking of Eldritch Moon. You know, sounds like a great time. Go to Australia, hang out, maybe come early, stay late. While you're here, you might as well play in the Pro Tour. No big deal, right, Paul?
That's kind of what a lot of the pros are looking to do. This is something that only affects a small number. It only affects people qualified for Pro Tour Eldritch Moon, the next Pro Tour. And basically, we all got an email yesterday, and the email said, well, for those of you guys planning on going to this Pro Tour, you guys are all going to need to apply for a visa. And when I just read that part, I'm like, oh, that's whatever. I got my visa, right? I got my vacation visa, right? If you got a U.S. passport, it takes 5 minutes, boom, out of being $20, you're set.
Right.
But no, this is not a regular run-of-the-mill visa. This is a temporary work visa.
Yep.
And it only lasts for 1 week. So a lot of people testing for 2 weeks can't even do that. It only lasts for 1 week. And I don't know. I mean, it seems like Wizards just recently found out. This whole thing's just kind of become a disaster.
A lot of
players are now concerned, too, because this visa says it could take up to 4 weeks.
And you need to do an interview.
Right.
I don't know if that's true or not, but Reitzel posted that apparently you need to do an interview.
It's just a giant hassle for something that, you know, It just kind of threw people off. If we knew way ahead of time, then maybe we would, you know. But this is like, yeah, you're going to have a four-week window. You should do this right away. And you need to get this temporary work visa.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, this doesn't make a lot of sense. Why would you have to do this? And a lot of the pros are like, wait. And not only that, this visa, $200. It's 10 times more expensive than the normal visa. And who's to say that you're just going to Australia to hang out with some friends? You're an American. You got the visa approved already, right?
Yeah.
Because I already applied for my normal vacation visa, and I got that approved electronically. I can now travel in and out for vacation. Who's to say that I just go there hanging out with some friends and then, there's a Pro Tour. I'm going to play in it. You know, and that's the thinking that a lot of the pros have right now.
I mean,
but obviously, it's a big risk, right? Because Wizards are saying, hey, you need to get this visa. It's like, well, are you not going to let us play in the Pro Tour if we don't have this visa? Because they haven't explicitly said that either. So
well,
it's,
I think you know they can't encourage you.
Of course,
to shirk
they,
this.
They can't duty. Make you. They can't encourage you to yeah. break the rules, but they haven't explicitly said that you can't. You know, that you can't play in the Pro Tour. So right. You know, a lot of people are like, hey, do I pay $200 and get this visa that may or may not come in time, or do I just say I'm going on a vacation with my friends and I'm just going to play in this Pro Tour? So it's. Yeah, it's the
it's
whole...
It's a crazy situation. I feel bad. I mean, obviously, I found out about this because Helene, director of Global Organized Play, Helene Bergeau, for Wizards of the Coast, posted on Facebook, like, you know, how bad a day she was having over this thing. And I was like, what's going on? You know, and then obviously, you know, we talked about it this morning.
I mean, they must have just found out. You know what I mean?
Like, of course they just found out.
And well, it the question is, you know, was this rule always in place? You know what I mean? Or was it like they were talking to the embassy or whoever, and they were just like, oh, by the way,
yeah,
all of the people traveling here, when you're booking flights, you guys only work visas because this looks a little fishy because you guys are booking flights for everybody. You know, like when did this happen? You know,
I mean, let me say this. I have absolutely zero idea. I have no. Sometimes I hear whispers. I have no inside information here. My suspicion, after having talked to you about it and learning more about the situation, is they probably at some point Wizards Legal probably looked at what was needed for their staff to travel over there and work for the people who are going to run the Pro Tour.
Okay.
And at that point, realized, wait a minute, you guys are going over there for work for a week. You need to do this special visa. It's not the regular visa. And as soon as they figured out, wait a minute, everyone who's running the tournament has to get this visa? Does that mean the pros have to get it too? And the penny dropped and it was like, oh my God, get an email out right now. That's complete conjecture on my part. I have no idea. But having put together, I think that's what happened.
Yeah,
They never looked at it for the pros. Not that they don't care, but they just, that wasn't on their radar.
But my thing is, it's like you're playing a thing and you can even just go home with no money. You're not even, you know, is that work if you go home and you put in the time and then you don't make anything? You know,
I mean,
or is it like I don't know exactly what the rules are for this kind of thing. So it's just all been a little hectic. And I know, yes, Helene was basically like, you know, we're probably just not going to do Pro Tours in Australia anymore because this is just way too much more of a hassle than it should be.
Right.
You know,
what's funny is Paul was saying, hey, man, I hope they move the Pro Tour. I hope they don't have to do this, blah, 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 blah. This is such a pain. I can't believe this. I can't even imagine. He's like, I speak English, I have a degree, and I'm having trouble filling these forms out. And Ifro was agreeing with him.
Yeah.
And then PV responds like, no, it's no problem at all. And this is pretty funny, because you always got to check yourself. PV's like, yeah, I'm used to this. This is what I have to fill out every time I come to the U.S. for a Pro Tour.
Right.
So the shoe's kind of on the other foot to some degree.
Right.
As Americans.
No, PV's loving it. PV's like,
the thing is like,
yeah, this is what people from foreign countries have to do all the time, but as stupid, spoiled Americans.
Right. And so it's so funny. We're all up in arms, and it's such a great check to read a statement like that. So thank you, PV. Just because it really brings us back to center, where it's like, we're up in arms. How could you do this? How could this be a thing? How could they expect this paperwork? How could they charge me for this visa? This is all crazy. And then, you know, PV was a bristle like, yeah, guys. You know how many Pro Tours I have in the U.S.? I have to do this for every Pro Tour in the U.S.
Yeah.
So temper expectations. Maybe it's not quite as crazy as one.
Yeah, I think it's more like people just kind of expect that. Hey, I mean, we already got this visa.
Yeah.
You know, I think that's the thing. People are like, we already got this visa.
It was a shocker to me. I was like, wait, what are you talking about?
It's like I already applied, and I did this kind of late too. I got this visa like over the weekend.
Wait, Magic player procrastinated?
I know. I should have procrastinated a little longer. Oh. I wouldn't have wasted my $20.
Right. Yeah, that's true. $20 down.
Yeah. Moral of the story.
In any case, I think we can safely say RIP to future Pro Tours in Australia.
Yeah, I can definitely see that.
I will say this. I think I know what's really happening here and what this is really about.
What's that?
TBS. All of a sudden, Ben Sek gets an invite to this Pro Tour, and all the American pros are having problems getting to the country. Not TBS, he's still an Australian.
He's
going to
be just the last man standing.
No problem.
And it's funny, too, in all the Facebook posts, you always just see TBS goes, man, it's good to be Australian.
I'm an Australian citizen. G'day, mates.
Throw the top eight, shrimp on the Ben Sek and seven other Australians, yeah. Because nobody else could make it
to
the country.
I am so on to you, TBS. As soon as I saw this happening, I was like, yeah. That Ben Sek, I knew it. So, if only you could undo all the difficulty. Well, in any case, you got to make it out there.
Yeah, definitely.
That's your ticket to gold. We all think you're in gold.
Yeah. I have to be able to register in the tournament. What's funny is I feel like if people aren't able to show up or get turned back, they're probably still just going to give you the 3 pro points, you know, just because of what happened.
I mean, it's tough.
But, like, I wouldn't want to do that. I wouldn't want to travel for 50 hours or whatever.
Well, here's the thing about it is, what if it's only Americans that are encountering this issue? Like, someone like
PD? No, I heard that everybody is.
But other foreigners who maybe are not Americans who are used to doing this ahead of time may have a leg up. But the problem is they may still have applied for the wrong visa. That's the real issue, right? They didn't know nobody knew what visa they applied for.
Like, for example, is PV applying for, has PV always had to apply for a work visa?
Yeah, I don't know.
Or is he just, I would imagine that he just applied for a normal visa to the US.
It just comes over, I think so too. Yeah.
So this is different, you know, because like on the main page, yeah. So once again, people are just saying like, how are they going to know? Yeah. Like you go through customs, you have your American passport, you already have the chip. If you have the chip for the normal visa, that is, right?
Yes.
Which is what almost every pro has already paid for. If you show up and you're just like, hey, you know, I'm just here on vacation, I got my chip, what are they going to do? You know? Obviously, it's a risk,
really?
And it's probably not worth it. But
why
I'm just saying, there are people who are going to
get it. Why don't you ask your buddy Johnny Depp what happens? You and your girlfriend and your two dogs that you brought in the country illegally, get on your plane and get out of here.
Is that
happened to Johnny Depp, yeah.
Oh.
He snuck. There's like a lot of rules about dogs on the island. I think they don't have rabies there.
Okay.
And, you know, he had his dogs and his, at the time, girlfriend, now wife, soon to be ex-wife, I think, flying on a private plane. So they didn't have to go through customs or anything with the dogs. And
right.
And they came out and they ended up having to get the heck out of the country. TBS,
so
for the record,
strict.
Is Ben Sec. The Ben Sec. That's what the TBS stands for. A local player now, right? But he is from Australia. So he's Australian. And he's a great guy. But he is behind all this. I'm convinced he's the mastermind who caused all of this heartache.
Damn over. You, Ben.
Yeah. Every person I've talked to about that, which is really you, me, and everybody watching Magic TV, completely agrees that I'm right about TBS being behind this. So, all right. You're still going to make it to the PT. Did you apply for the new visa?
I have not yet. No.
Paul, you got the email.
I got the email yesterday.
You got the email yesterday, dude.
All right, I'll do it tomorrow.
You work from home.
Yeah.
On the internet, where you can apply for this. You literally work from home, Paul.
Well, I actually don't have a printer at home.
You fill it out electronically.
I know, but so I need to, but the thing is, you need to get something from Wizards, too, like some kind of permission, like a letter.
You could start filling it out before that. Oh, my God.
Well, you can start filling it out, but yeah.
Paul, okay, what's...
It doesn't matter until you get the thing from Wizards.
What is making gold worth?
I don't know.
Financially.
A few grand.
So basically, you're being paid a few grand to get this paperwork filled out.
All right, I'll do it tomorrow.
You better do.
I have to submit my vacation request. I have to submit my travel request. Tomorrow's the last day.
Vacation request.
No. Tomorrow's the last day.
Dear Lisa, I'd like to go to the Pro Tour in Australia. Yeah.
They said you have until the 30th of June. I have not submitted it yet, so I need to do it tomorrow.
Lisa, no, Paul. It needs to be written. I need it dated and signed, and you know you have to have this in 3 weeks ahead of time. Otherwise, it's an automatic no.
Yeah.
So, get it done, dude.
I'll do it. I'll do it tomorrow.
Are you going to get it done before the CSL?
I will do it before the CSL.
All of you who watch the CSL, you all make sure Paul has completed his visa application for PT Eldrick Moon. That is on all of you, okay? Do it. Just do it.
That's going to be fun.
Enough said on PT Eldrick Moon. Let's talk about a little bundle of joy that popped out, what, about 3 hours now? 2.5
yeah,
hours now?
Something like that, 2 or 3 hours ago.
The new, I wanted to speculate on a name. Now we actually know a name, but I don't want to say anything about that. I feel awful if Luis hasn't announced this already.
He has.
Okay, good. Did he announce a name?
I believe he did, yes.
He did?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
So, Nia Scott Vargas Sarcedo. I'm telling you, Sarcedo Scott Vargas sounds better to me.
Yeah, I guess. But
no.
Congratulations to Luis.
Congratulations. I know he was on Pins and Needles. We actually had a call. Luis, Channel Firewall president. Oh, my God. Burgo just pulled up a picture.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, she's cute.
Yeah. Good mix.
There's no card called Nia. Nia Scott Vargas Sarcedo. But no, honestly. What do you, just seriously, honestly, do you think Saucedo Scott Vargas sounds better or not? Because for whatever reason, it actually just rings better in my mind, Saucedo Scott Vargas. It seems to roll off the tongue a little
Scott
bit.
Scott Vargas Saucedo is fine, too.
Of course it's fine.
I mean, like, the way it sounds, I don't think one is better than the other.
Burglar, do you have a stance on this? Scott Vargas Saucedo or Saucedo Scott Vargas?
Scott Saucedo, no Vargas in there. Just melt the two.
That is not an option, Burglar.
Yours is better.
Okay, thank you. I definitely think it should be Saucedo Scott Vargas. So maybe
you can tell that to Geneva.
You know what?
Yeah, that's what I thought. See, that's why I'm not arguing about this.
That's why, you know, I would never troll Geneva at all. She has to live with. She lives with Luis. The woman goes through enough.
Yeah.
So all love and respect in the world to Geneva Saucedo, and congratulations. Obviously, as I was saying, Channel Fireball President CEO John Sasso and I were on a call with Luis on Monday, and you could kind of tell like. The nerves were setting, and this was before she'd gone to labor or anything. But.
Yeah. But, I mean, this was a little bit early, and, he was messaging me yesterday, and he's just like, we're about to head to the hospital, and they were there for a while. I'm just glad everything, the baby looks totally healthy, everything's good.
10 fingers, 10 toes.
Yeah, that's right, right. You got to make sure.
Yeah.
You got to make sure.
So, this is awesome. Congratulations, Luis, honestly, from all of us here at Magic TV and Channel 5.
We were trying to figure out, we went to the baby shower, we were trying to figure out what the last name of the baby is going to be because Luis has a hyphenated last name and, Geneva just kept her last name. So we were like, what is going to happen? And it looks like they just went full on just the triple name.
But that's not the last name, right?
No, the last name is legally Saucedo.
Yeah.
And the middle name is Scott Vargas.
Which kills me, Luis, because Luis...
Without a hyphen, there's no hyphens anywhere.
I actually had this conversation with Luis a while ago, right when he let everyone know that they were pregnant. I said, is it going to be Saucedo Scott Vargas? And he's like, no, there will not be a hyphenated last name. We've already decided no hyphenated last name. So he's right, there's no hyphenated last name,
right.
It's just Saucedo, but...
Yeah, he's going full, like, PV, PVDDR.
Can we agree that there were definitely negotiations involved with the last name? Luis got Naya as a first name, and Geneva was like... Saucedo is the last name then.
Yep.
I feel like that is, I have no, again, no inside information. I feel like that is almost exactly what happened.
Yeah, he saw Dave Williams, his daughter's name is Liliana. So he's just like, I'm going to try to run this too. His next child's son probably going to be like Jund.
Grixis.
Those don't even sound that
Jund,
great.
Jund is so-so.
He can name it Jace.
Jace.
Just Jace. Jace is like a real name.
What about Abzan?
That sounds terrible.
Teemer Scott.
None of those sound
Teemer
good
Scott
at
Vargas?
All. None of those sound good.
Teemer Saucedo.
Jess
Scott
guy
Vargas.
Maybe.
No.
Is that no?
Teemer Saucedo Scott Vargas. Come on.
Garrick.
Bant is awful. Bant is truly awful.
Gideon.
Or Kithian. Because Gideons, there's other Gideons out there. Ain't no
what
Kithians
about just like
there.
Jack or something? Just
or Paul, Paul Saucedo Scott Vargas. Paul Scott Vargas Saucedo. All right, congratulations, Luis. If you haven't seen pictures of the baby, they are live on the Twitterverse. So check out Luis at LSV, and you can see pictures of the newest addition to the Scott Vargas Saucedo clan, Naya Scott Vargas Saucedo. Well. It is funny because I do feel like we just finished everything with Eternal Masters, and all of a sudden, when I was thinking about MTV this week, I was like, we'll have maybe 5 or 6 preview cards that we can talk about.
No, a ton came out recently.
So many, right? Like, we can't even talk about all of them.
Yeah.
Before we dive into those, we can talk about some of the mechanics here. Madness is still present. Obviously, we know Madness. Madness, by the way, just as a name, is so appropriate for Innistrad, isn't it? Like, Madness being Innistrad, obviously, no accident there it's been Innistrad.
And then Emrakul. Making everybody crazy transforming people.
The insanity. And melding.
Yeah.
What do you think of melding?
I mean, it's a new mechanic. I'm willing to see how it plays out and before making too many judgments on it, It is pretty awkward sometimes where if something gets melded and then you kill it and then you... end up losing a lot of value. But
it's a 2-for-1, right? When it happens, it's a 2-for-1.
I just found out, though, how meld actually works in terms of how you're actually supposed to play with it. Apparently, the flip side of the card is half of a card.
The image is half, yeah. So when they meld, they meld, and then you kind of do something like that.
Yeah,
you
so you have
it, and it goes like
yeah,
that.
So you have, like, 2 cards with meld, and on the flip side, half of it is one picture, half of it's the other?
No, half of it's one picture, the other half's the text. The flavor, the rules box, the text box.
Okay, I see.
So it's
Is it like a double-sided card then? Right?
They're all double-sided cards. Yeah.
Okay. So it's they're like, gonna have to sleeve
these
too.
It's similar to BFG. Yeah.
BFM. The big furry monster.
Yeah. BFG, this real doll book. Yeah, it's similar to that. Only I think it's. I think it's vertical. I don't think it's horizontal the way BFM is.
So okay.
BFM is like, you know, it's kind of like two cards like this. Yeah. The meld cards are like two cards like
that. It's like super banding.
It is. It's interesting. Yeah. Wouldn't it be so much cooler if the meld failed or the creature died, they like un-Voltroned back into their original pieces?
Yeah. That would be too much value though, probably.
You think so? Yeah. Because
it would make like your removal so bad because like you kill it and then you just get two of it back.
It's tough trying to find... You're right. That's too good. But there's everything with meld. Like there's this huge potential for a 2-for-1, right? You're like you're just begging for that 2-for-1.
Yeah.
You know, like but, Bruna, Gisela, Brizella, Stony Silence or whatever. Yeah. You know, not Stony Silence, but why am I blanking?
Stasis Snare.
Whatever.
Yeah. I mean, the cards when they do get melded are very very powerful, so it's likely worth it. The problem, the thing that I notice is that meld is not a may, it is a must, which I don't like.
You have to do it, but keep in mind, it's always a may, because you don't need to play both the cards.
No, but like both of the cards could just be very good creatures, and then like...
Doesn't exist yet now, though.
What?
I mean, you...
Yes, look, there, it does.
Gisela's great.
Gisela's great, and so is Bruna. And
Bruna's not great.
Well, like, they're both good creatures, what I'm saying. Let's say
I don't even think Bruna's a good creature.
Well, if you're playing it in your Gisela deck, it is.
Yeah, but that... At that point, you're saying you want to melt.
It's not even necessarily to melt. Her ability to return an angel onto the battlefield is pretty strong. You can play Gisela's Archangel Avacyn and play like one or two copies of Bruna.
I mean, that's where it becomes crazy. Bruna can get back your Avacyn or whatever.
Right.
But you are always... I mean, yes, the meld is a must, not a may, but you're always in the driver's seat with whether you're going to trigger that must. Right? If you don't want Brizella... Don't play Bruna, or don't when you have Bruna out, don't play Gisela.
Yeah, well, I mean, there are times where, like, you cast a Bruna because somebody killed your Gisela, and then it comes into play, and then you're just like, oh, it'd be nice if I just had both of these creatures.
Yeah, but at that point, you're like, or it'd be nice if I just had a 7-mana, like, 9-7 or 9-10 flying lifelink, first strike, vigilance, you don't play converted mana cost, 3 or less spells, this thing. I don't even like look at the card. The card like hurts your eyes, like sucks your soul
Brizella?
Out of your eyeball. Yeah, Brizella.
It's so sad.
Really is.
Yeah.
Brizella is one of the saddest Magic cards ever made.
It looks pretty awful.
We should do top 8 sad Magic cards. Brizella. Sure. Brizella would be up there.
Yeah.
Brizella would be up there. But yeah, so we have meld, we have madness. I mean, does the flip? Is flipping an ability?
Which it triggers.
I mean, do you count that as an ability for the set? The flip mechanic?
Mm-hmm. I think that's just part of meld.
No. I mean, Huntmaster of the Fells, Delver of Secrets.
Right.
That flip thing, is that... Would you consider that an ability like madness?
Oh, a flip?
It doesn't quite feel like it, but it has to be, right?
Sure.
I don't know. I'm saying it's like it's.
Well,
like,
I think they're all different. They're all different, though. So I consider them all like unique. I consider them all different abilities.
No, I do too.
Like the werewolf flip. You know, the conditional flip on like Delver, and you know.
Wait,
like
you think those are different abilities? Those are the same ability, right? The Delver and the werewolf flip.
I guess so. Melding is completely
melding
different,
is completely
though.
Different. Yeah. Completely, yeah. Completely different.
Right.
I think that you know it's. It's interesting.
Yeah.
I actually still have high hopes for this set. I know we mentioned this earlier. You had some skepticism about whether this set will have an impact on Standard. I think it will. I actually think it will. There's a lot to see so far. Let's talk about some of these cards that are we've already seen in Eldritch Moon. First up, we've already mentioned her a few times, Gisela the Broken Blade. It's weird. All three of these cards, Gisela, Bruna, and Brizella, all three of them would make the list of kind of like top 8. I guess it has to be one entry, the top 8 into the saddest cards, right? Because Gisela is awesome, but this is just horrible. Gisela the Broken Blade, 2 white, 2 other for a 4/3 flying First Strike Lifelink. At the beginning of your end step, if you own and control Gisela, the Broken Blade, and a creature named Bruna, the Fading Light, exile them and meld them into Brizella, Voice of Nightmares. Let's just talk about Gisela right now. When we get to Bruna, we'll also talk about Brizella. But Gisela, I mean, 4 mana, 4-3, flying First Strike Lifelink.
Yeah.
That is legendary right. Angel. So you only have one.
So when you're just looking at just the eye test, like not talking about like the removal in the format or sure. what have you, obviously this card just seems ridiculous, right? Against like various aggressive strategies. But now you have to, you know, put it in context to the format with the way Standard is. And, you know, like, first of all, it's a 4-mana creature. Can't collect a company into it.
Yep.
Right? It's fighting for slots. If you're looking to maybe jam it into like green-white, you know, it's fighting over something like a Gideon mm-hmm. or what have you. And if you look at kind of the control decks, every single removal spell kills it.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Ultimate Price, Grasp of Darkness, mm-hmm. you know, all the various, the conditional removal spell, all of them kills this creature. But if it ever lives, this card's insane.
Yeah.
You know, against like the humans deck. If they don't have the Declaration in stone, like they're just not going to be able to beat this card.
Done. Right.
You know, and there's also that added bonus, obviously. Like, if you just look at it as a 4-mana, 4-3 flying First Strike Lifelink, that card's obviously very, very good. But if it dies, you know, she is linked to
Bruna.
Well, Bruna,
she's an
so,
angel.
Right. So I can see this. You know, people are obviously going to try this out. It's obviously very, very powerful. It's been pushed. Mm-hmm. And, you know, people are going to probably try this out in maybe more of a control deck.
It's
maybe black white. A lot of people suggest that maybe she'll see some play in black white control because like you can play it and then if it dies, you're not too sad if you're playing some copies of Bruna as well just to get her back.
Right.
Late
and game. I mean, she gives you the lifelink. She's like a mini, I think it was like kind of a mini Baneslayer.
Definitely.
You know,
but Baneslayer dodges way more removal.
Way more removal. Way more resilient. The lifelink is so huge when we talk about the control side.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Bruna, the Fading Light, the other half of this sad duo. 2 mana, 5 other, 2 white, 5 other, for a legendary angel horror. They're both angel horrors. When you cast Bruna the Fading Light, you may return target angel or human creature card from your graveyard to the battlefield. She has flying vigilance. And then, of course, she melds with Gisela, and it's not a may, it's a must. And the idea here is, yeah, okay, Gisela drops down, ends up getting killed. Oh, no, what are you going to do? Well, it's pretty simple. You drop Bruna, you return Gisela from the graveyard to play, you wait till your end step, and then you get Brizella.
Yeah.
Voice of Nightmares.
So, obviously, this is a very powerful effect. It is still a 7-drop.
Yeah.
You know, that's still a pretty expensive. That's a pretty big cost. So, you know, if people are going to be looking to play this, maybe one.
It definitely would have to be 4
It'd be
right?
One, maybe 2. Like, maybe the sideboard, if you really want to go deep.
This
in like,
card's not good.
No, in the control matchups.
I know, but this card's not good, is it?
No, obviously it's not, but, like, the whole idea is, you know, it's a way to grind people out. Standard has just turned into this grind fest where everybody's just trying to, like, get little advantages here and there, you know, going back from, like, Jeskai Black to what it is now,
yeah.
where people are trying to go over the top with Evolutionary Leaps and all these other cards. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it is that card. It's a card that, like, look, we're going to just play our spells, everybody just playing their mythic rares, and then I'm going to play this card, which allows me to, you know, create this gigantic monster that is going to be really hard to deal with.
Or get Avacyn back.
Yeah.
I mean, the ability to get Avacyn back is actually pretty sweet, and it's like one of the things that I think cuts in favor of Bruna. Get that angel tribal deck going.
Yeah, yeah.
No longer on the kitchen table.
Having Avacyn in play is also pretty good.
Yeah.
Also, that makes it so that you don't have to flip
You
her.
Don't melt. Right.
Right.
Yeah. You know, you're stuck with this 5/7...
Yeah.
Flying vigilance creature.
Right.
So the possibilities there, obviously, you know, you can very easily.
Obviously, also in limited discards, insane.
Yeah.
Because well, you can, the human part is way more relevant
for
limited.
For unlimited, yeah.
Yeah
well,
yeah,
I
yeah.
mean, Gisela's insane in limited, too, though.
Yeah, I guess so.
4/3 flying.
Yeah, Gisela's actually a lot better in limited.
Yes, she is. It's like, turn 4 Gisela in limited is just going to be like. I mean,
yeah,
you better have an answer now.
Exactly.
Before things get way out of control. All right. Tree of Perdition. 1/3 for a 0/13 tree. This sounds so eerily familiar, doesn't it?
Do you think they're just going to print like a tree of every color and just give it a different name?
With a different ability?
Different ability.
Well,
yes.
These are the polar opposite abilities.
Right.
Defender, tap to exchange target opponent's life total with Tree of Perdition's toughness. Of course, this is the opposite of Tree of Redemption.
Right. So Tree of Redemption was pretty great because against all the different aggressive decks, it just bought you a ton of time.
Right.
This one plays a little differently. It is pretty cool, But, like, I don't know how you're going to, like, there's got to be a way to, like, take advantage of this. Like,
I mean, so if you get it online, and your opponent's still at 20, you can 7 them, but now your Tree of Perdition's at a 0-20, right?
Exchange target opponent's life total with Tree. Yeah, so you can only use it once.
Yeah. No, I mean, you can use it over and over, right? But you...
Yeah.
You need to find a way to lower the Tree of Perdition's.
Right.
Well, I mean,
you could make it small.
You get... Well, the thing is, like, the worst case scenario here is, I guess, you 7 your opponent and have a 0-20 wall, which is not bad, but it's not really good.
Yeah. Like, getting your opponent to 13 just doesn't seem like it does a whole lot when you're playing a tree in your deck. Like, when you're playing a card like this, obviously you want it in, like, kind of more of a controlling slow deck, so dealing that 7 damage doesn't seem very relevant.
Right.
So there's got to be some other way to abuse this. But, you know, I guess they were just like, hey, oh, we have a Tree of Redemption, so let's go with Tree of Perdition. There is a combo people in the chat have mentioned, Triskaidekaphobia.
Oh,
put him to 13.
God.
Bam!
Oh, my God.
Game.
Oh, someone tell Newmont. Huh? I heard he loves that card.
Huh? Oh, God.
Oh, my. Wow, combo. Wizards, yeah. We caught on.
We got it.
It's like, I'm not doing anything about that enchantment.
Oh, you can get it up. Can you imagine getting that off in Limited? Whew. That would be
sweet. You'd be living the dream.
Live the dream. That
awesome.
Is possible.
That would be awesome.
Yeah.
All right. Next up, Ulrich of the Kralin Horde. 1 green, 1 red, 3 other. Whenever this creature enters the battlefield or transforms into Ulrich of the Kralin Horde, target creature gets +4/+4 until end of turn. At the beginning of each upkeep, if no spells were cast last turn, transform Ulrich. When you transform him, he becomes Ulrich Uncontested Alpha. With whenever this creature transforms into Ulrich Uncontested Alpha, you may have it fight target non-werewolf creature you don't control. So you can never have it accidentally fight one of your own guys, which is nice. It's a 6/6, so it fights for 6.
Yeah. That's literally, like they printed a worse Wolfier Silverheart at Mythic, and this is supposed to be your legendary werewolf.
This is your alpha?
This is your uncontested alpha. Come on, you could. This is. It just feels so vanilla.
It was weird. I love the art.
Right.
And when I read the first side of it, Ulrich of the Kralin Horde, I'm like, okay, this thing must flip into something really sweet.
No, and you flip into 6/6.
Yeah, you're like,
He needs to make like an army of wolves, or also be like an anthem.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Something.
Like Master of the Wild Hunt style, like, yeah, make a wolf
that
and
would
turn.
Be unbelievable.
You know what I mean? And
yes.
Tap it to fight.
Yes.
You know what
that
I mean?
That would make sense.
But like,
he should flip and create other wolves and then be able to tap and have them all fight.
Yeah.
That makes sense. He's the alpha. That's
yeah,
a good
this
call.
Just feels very rare to me.
Yeah.
And I mean, yeah, I don't really foresee this seeing a whole lot of play. I mean, the come into play ability to like +4/+4 big.
If
you have like, if there is like an aggressive red green deck, which there currently aren't, there currently isn't any, like, you know, maybe you can play this as the top end.
Yeah.
But
I think you could find a home. But yes, looking at Ulrich when it first started off, when I just saw the front of it, I was like, man, this guy's gonna flip into something sweet. And I have to admit, I flipped him, and I was just kind of like, I mean, look, dude, fighting for 6, it's removal. It's automatic. You're not spending any resources past the initial casting cost of Ulrich into it. So you're getting that removal for free if it goes off. So that, yeah, all of that's great. Don't get me wrong.
Masha, I'm going to give this like the biggest insult that when evaluating a card for Construct, there you go. This is good and limited.
This is good and limited, yeah. This card is a bomb and limited.
Yeah, that's all I have to say.
We did say that about Gisela, but she's good across the board.
Right.
Yeah, Ulrich, oh man, such a bomb and limited.
Yeah.
All right, Hanweir Garrison. 1 red, 2 other for a 2/3. Whenever a Hanweir Garrison attacks, put 2/1/1 red human creature tokens onto the battlefield, tapped and attacking. Now, this card also has Mel, but let's just talk about the Garrison here for a second. 3 mana, 2/3. Every time it swings, you put 2/1/1s into the battlefield, tapped and attacking. What do you think of that?
Certainly pretty powerful effect. For 3 mana, you're getting... You know, if you get to attack, that's
4 damage.
That's 4 power, 5 toughness.
Until next turn.
Right.
When it's 6 power, 7 toughness.
Right, well, it just keeps growing. I'm trying to figure out where the best place to, you know, like, the home for this deck. If you were to maybe actually make a red-white humans deck, this could be pretty cool.
Sure.
Right? The tokens obviously doesn't turn on always watching, but being able to double pump your Thalia's Lieutenant and just getting for a ton of damage, right? Yeah. And you go one drop into Thalia's Lieutenant into this and you attack, and that's just a ton of damage. So I can see some potential there. You know, maybe is there like a mono red strategy that like needed a creature and this puts it over the top? I don't know.
I think it's a good creature. He's solid. He's a good ability, but yeah, it doesn't have a home yet.
Right.
Yet.
But once again, I mean, for 3 mana, you are getting 4 power.
You're getting a lot of value out of him for 3 mana. And the fact that it's not 4 power that goes away. You get those 1/1s, and then you get more 1/1s. As long as those 1/1s stand, you get more and more. And then there's a card that it melds with, Hanweir Battlements. So non-basic land, tap to add 1 weird mana to your mana pool. 1 red, tap it, target creature gains haste until end of turn. 2 red, 3 other, tap. If you both own and control Hanweir Battlements and a creature named Hanweir Garrison, exile them, then meld them into Hanweir, the Writhing Township. And then Hanweir, the Writhing Township, it's a 7/4 with trample haste. Whenever it attacks, you put 2/3/2 colorless Eldrazi horror creatures tokens into the battlefield, tapped and attacking.
That does a lot.
It is a lot. I actually like it.
That's 13 power, by the way.
No, if you get a swing off with the Writhing Township, I mean, that's a lot. There's a lot going on there.
Right.
I actually like this combo. I think both are playable. I know you have your doubts about the land. I mean, weird mana is not really a thing now as much.
My biggest concern with this card is obviously it's very powerful, but, you know, when I was looking at the red creature, I was like, oh, okay, well, maybe this goes into a red-white humans deck. Can you really afford to play a colorless land in your deck that has... No. You know, that's basically just white weenie. It would have to be a different deck.
Right.
It would have to be kind of a more of a mid-range strategy. Some people were talking about like red-white tokens or maybe even red-green tokens or something like that, you know, with Nissas and stuff like that. I can see it maybe finding a home there, but in just straight red-white humans, probably not so much.
Yeah, I don't think it's a good fit for
red-white. They are making some pretty sweet utility lands.
Yeah, and I think
with Westvale Abbey and Hanweir Battlements.
Battlements is good. I mean, it's tough, one red. We were just talking before, one red, one other. I wish you gave some kind of attack bonus, like +1, +0, +2, +0.
Yeah, Mashi wanted to give it +2, +0, and haste. I'm like, Slayer Stronghold? He's like, no, but it doesn't give vigilance.
It doesn't give vigilance, and it only costs 1 red.
So it's a lot better.
It is a lot better. I mean, it is a lot better. There's no question it's a lot better.
Right.
Too good. That's why they don't let me design cards for Wizards of the Coast.
Yes, it would just be all pillages.
It would be really, really be all pillages. That'd be awesome. All right, next up, Blood... Hall Priest, 1 red, 1 black, 2 other for a 4/4 Vampire Cleric. So it's a right off the bat, 4 mana, 4/4. You know,
it's decent.
It's good. There was a time when that was amazing, right? There was a time when it was like, wow, that's a really good value.
Right.
In the current Magic scene, that's good. Whenever Blood Hall Priest enters the battlefield or attacks, if you have no cards in hand, Hellbent, Blood Hall Priest deals 2 damage to target creature or player, and you can throw her into play for a madness cost of 1 red, 1 black.
So Arrogant Worm cost, no trample, is pretty sweet if you can pull it off. You know, if the madness decks, you're trying to just empty out your hand. You have cards like Asylum Visitor, whatever. This is another attempt at Wizards trying to make a black red vampire deck. I thought black red vampires was going to be a thing.
We all did. I meant it. Yeah. Olivia looks good. I mean,
Olivia was obviously pushed, and they try to make all these things work, but. Just the green-white decks are just too good.
Green-white's been way too good. And,
yeah.
And red-black just hasn't... It hasn't... It's always weird because they're spoon-feeding us the synergy. And for some reason, it just doesn't... It's not gelling. It's not doing...
Not enough good two-drops, I don't think.
Yeah.
You know, you need to be able to curve out, and they just did not print good enough creatures at the two-mana slot, I think, to make this deck actually playable.
Yeah, and this isn't helping it. I think it's a solid creature. It's a good creature. But at 4 mana, 4/4...
It's not a card to me that says, oh, this is going to put the vampire deck over the top, right?
It's not like...
You start with 4 Olivia, because Olivia is obviously very powerful.
She's central to it, right?
But you need something a little more, I think. I mean, obviously, this is still early.
It's not going to hurt.
Yeah,
right.
This is early, too. So, you know, maybe they print, an amazing Madness Outlet for 2 mana.
Wizards has a history of Madness Outlets at 2 mana. I don't think they want to go down.
What if they just straight up print Red Looter?
Red Looter? What if they just straight up... print red mongrel.
Yes. Yes, red mongrel.
Even better, you can madness.
Because they have red Aquamoeba, but you can't stack damage anymore. If they just made like a red mongrel.
Yeah, red mongrel. Red mongrel that doesn't change colors. Because that was a huge problem. +1/+1, sure. You don't get to change colors. You are a red mongrel. You will stay.
Well, no
red
matter
mongrel.
What color you change it into, it still gets ultimate price. That's good.
That's true. Yeah, yeah. removal's not the same as it once was.
Yeah,
for sure. But yeah, I think there is a focus here on trying to push that red black vampire thing, which I support, by the way.
Because they
I still believe
they,
in that deck.
Because they failed in the last set.
Right.
You know, they really with Battle for Zendikar, they did a great job. Eldrazi was very, very powerful and played everywhere. But with vampires. Did not get there. Oh, same thing. Delirium also did not get there.
Yeah, it's not happening. So
yeah,
they can get there. It's always, but then you know when you try to push things too much, you end up with a 4-mana Jace the Mind Sculptor instead of 5-mana Jace the Mind Sculptor.
Yeah, though sometimes when you're trying to make these pre-constructed decks, it becomes a little too oppressive.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's why like they're trying to like make sure that they have that good balance. But I think in this case for the vampire deck, you need to push it a little more, a couple more good madness removal spells maybe.
That'll do it.
You know, not just Fiery Temper.
Right.
Maybe like a you know, 2-mana just destroy target creature
or,
for madness.
You know, madness of 2 red, 1 other, destroy target land or artifact. I mean, they're pretty huge right now. They're pretty huge right now. Probably right to ship. Wizards, I hope you're listening. All right, next up, take inventory. 1 blue, 1 other, sorcery, draw a card, then draw cards equal to the number of cards named take inventory in your graveyard.
Okay, so what? Accumulated knowledge, right?
No. Let's get one thing clear here. This is not accumulated knowledge.
Look, yeah, I'm looking at the website, I'm looking at Mythic Spoil, and it's showing me.
Not accumulated knowledge.
Thesaurus, accumulated knowledge.
Not accumulated knowledge.
No?
It is so much worse than accumulated knowledge. It's unbelievable how much worse than accumulated knowledge this is.
Well, yeah, I mean, the whole reason, like, accumulated knowledge was great, but the reason why it was great, too, is because you could play this controlled strategy where you say draw, go, you can either counter your opponent's spell or draw cards. This just doesn't give you that option. So, playing a sorcery, draw one card is just not that impressive.
Right.
One upside, I guess maybe you could call it upside, is accumulated knowledge was all graveyards, so you don't have to play this weird, like,
That was why AK was insane, though.
Did you like that?
Oh, dude, you'd sit there with AK, and if you were in a match where your opponent had AKs, it was like...
I thought that was silly.
As soon as they play their AK, you don't want to be the first one to play an AK.
Of course.
You don't want to
That's
cycle
bad.
Your AK.
But it also just feels bad to just have, like, 2 AKs in your hand
no,
and
it
missing
doesn't,
land drops.
Once, okay. There comes a time when you have to play.
Right.
You can't sit there and miss land drops, because normally if you're playing AK, you're not playing aggro, you're playing control.
Yeah.
So sometimes you have to, but when you're sitting there staring down... You never want to play the first AK.
Yeah.
But that's why take inventory is just nowhere near as good as accumulated knowledge. The sorcery instant thing, yeah, that's huge. Don't get me wrong. But you're not gonna cast your second take inventory and draw 3 cards off of it, right? That's not gonna happen.
Yeah. This just doesn't seem like it's just gonna be good enough. Like you have all these just great creature decks that are curving out, and you're just 2-mana sorcery, draw 1 card. Like if you really want a blue deck to be viable, you gotta push it. You gotta just maybe I don't know if AK would be too good.
Maybe if it was AK only your graveyard.
Yeah, I mean, but like, I'm trying to think. Would that?
I think that would actually be fine.
The thing is, like, blue needs so much help right now. The best blue creature, or the best blue card, is Reflector Mage.
What if it's take inventory, for 1 blue.
Oh, sorcery?
Yeah.
Okay, that'd be too good. Like one blue is just
such
a...
so busted.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I'll draw one, draw two, I'll Ancestral.
Well, one is obviously insane because early on you can still just keep up mana to do other things, but I don't even know if accumulated knowledge would be busted. It would actually just help the blue decks because the blue decks right now are just unplayable.
I think if you split the difference one way or another, made it an instant where it only counted your graveyard, or made it a sorcery where it counted all graveyards. I think either one of those two options actually would be pretty good.
Yeah.
I mean, all graveyards, you know, if you go first, then I'm 2-mana sorcery, draw 2 cards.
What if they made it like an instant, but it costs 4, and you start with drawing 2 cards? So it's inspiration, and then becomes like, draw 3 4-mana,
you draw
3 4-mana.
Four. You double, or do you just draw one more?
Just one more. So like the second one is 4-mana draw 3 instant, which is pretty good. Like, that's really good.
A 4-mana draw 3?
Yeah.
It's then
4-mana, like, draw 4.
Is insane.
Yeah.
4-mana draw 4 is insane.
Yeah.
I don't know. I like either making it the sorcery, all graveyards, or the instant your graveyard only.
Sure.
I'd rather only spend 2 mana. That's why.
No. I agree that AK is better. I'm just saying if they wanted to do another take, the sorcery speed thing, just I don't think is going to make it standard playable. You could live the dream in draft, though. In draft.
That would be insane. Well, now we're talking about cold snap draft all over again.
Yeah, but I guess you're not drafting like triple of this set, so it's not
You can't quite live that dream.
Yeah.
All right. Oh, one of the mechanics we forgot to dive into. Elder Deep Fiend, 8 mana, 5/6 with flash and emerge. The emerge cost of the spell is 2 blue, 5. When you cast Elder Deep Fiend, tap up to 4 target permanents. Now let me explain emerge here. You may cast this spell by sacrificing a creature and paying the emerge cost reduced by that creature's converted mana cost. Now, so the emerge cost is 2 blue, 5 for this guy. So if you sacrifice a 5 mana creature, you only have to play 2 blue to put him into play.
Yeah, and you can't make the blue cheaper. You can't sack a blue creature.
Yeah, of course.
But it's just colorless. But yes, you can just sack 5 mana creature and 2 blue flash. How big is it again?
5/6.
Yeah.
Tap
4 target permanents. Now keep in mind though, sacking a 5-drop is like a pretty big cost.
Yeah.
But the effect is also very, very strong. So it's like
it'd be interesting if it was sacrifice any number of creatures.
Oh, jeez. Yeah.
I don't want to get that. Tokens have 0, so it doesn't. You know, it's like you can't sack a bunch of tokens to get this thing out.
Yeah, that's true. You're actually like sacking a real creature to pull this off.
You have to do that. Yeah.
But yeah, so I'm trying to figure out like where this would have like a good home. Maybe some kind of Eldrazi deck. Mm-hmm. You have like decks that play Drowner.
Right.
Like, that's pretty good.
It's interesting because this kind of...
Does it say when it comes into the battlefield?
No, when you cast.
Okay. That's really important because of Eldrazi Displacer.
Right.
Yeah.
It's interesting because this is kind of like just another kind of meld, right? It's just a different... It's like the Eldrazi thing is melding, right? So you get the two spells that actually meld, or you just say, hey, that creature and this card in my hand are melding. This creature's gone, and now you're just this thing. So
yeah,
and you have this opportunity. Both mechanics open yourself up to potential 2-for-1s.
Right. Well, yeah, that's
what's kind of scary about it.
Yeah. I mean, the effect is powerful enough where you have to be like, well, this. I mean, it's flash. You can flash it in for a discounted rate, and you get this gigantic body.
Right.
Like so. I mean.
So what you're doing is at end of turn, I'm sacking a creature, flashing in this 5/6, tapping whatever 4 blockers you have up, and then getting in for 5 if I need to or whatever.
Well, yeah, no, you know what kind of reminds me of? Like Mistbind Click.
Sure.
Right?
Sure.
So, like, let's say your opponent's
nowhere near as good.
Well, yeah, but let's say your opponent's got some creatures, and you're like, all right, I'm going to attack you. Mm-hmm. It's like, all right, I'm going to play this, I'm going to tap down your lands, and then I'm going to eat one of your creatures, and now I have this monster, and you just lost your turn because you didn't play something on your main phase.
Right.
Or you can go tap down your lands. Yeah. I had this giant creature. Right. So, I mean, I think there's enough applications, enough potential where people are at least going to give this a shot.
Yeah, and that's the thing about it is it actually is just 4 permanents, which is rare. Normally you see things that say 4 non-land permanents, but you're just tapping here. So you can use this during an upkeep to lock down your opponent.
Right.
Yeah, which is something to keep in mind. And that's part of what can make this a good card.
Yeah.
All right, Thalia, the new Thalia. Heretic Cathar, 1 white, 2 for a legendary human soldier with first strike, 3/2 legendary soldier with first strike. Creatures and non-basic lands your opponents control enter the battlefield tapped.
This card seems pretty good.
You can play both Thalias, right?
You can play both Thalias. Well, no.
I think
They would. Oh, wait, they're different names,
they're
right?
Different
it's
names.
Not Planeswalker, so yeah. You can play
both.
Yeah.
It's interesting. You can really slow your opponent down here.
Yeah.
Can you imagine? You already said this. When you have that fetch land and you're playing against Thalia.
Right. Yeah. You have to get a basic.
Yeah.
Because if you just have if your opponent goes like turn 3 Thalia, like in Modern or whatever, your opponent goes like turn 3 Thalia and you just have all these fetch lands in your hand, you're like, oh my god.
Yeah.
This is just going to be
miserable.
Yeah. So,
miserable.
I mean, Hate Bears has like, an additional potential, something to play with here, right?
Yeah, something to really get it over there.
People have been playing some Vryn Wingmares or whatever, or even Mind Sensors. I mean, this creature could just replace all those in the various Hate Bear decks.
Yeah.
I mean, it costs 3 mana, so, I don't know how many of these you can jam into your deck.
Right.
But it is a pretty nice ability.
I think it's a really nice ability.
Turn 2 Thalia, turn 3 Thalia. Oh,
yeah,
my God.
Thalia continues.
Thalias for days.
Yeah, Thalia is like the new. The Thalias are like the new mascot for Hate Bears. I feel like
the question is this going to see play in Standard? Probably, in humans.
Yeah, for 3/2. I mean, it's all their creatures too.
Yeah.
Keep that. Don't forget that every creature your opponent plays comes into play tapped.
Right.
Not that.
Also, just a lot of decks just play a bunch of non-basics.
Yeah.
If you're playing like mono white. Right, and you just curve out and you play this, like your opponent can't play their company on turn four, like.
And that's the whole thing about it, is when you're playing mono white, playing an aggro deck, you're doing two amazing things to slow them down.
Right.
Their creatures are coming in tapped, and their non-basics are coming in tapped. And all you're trying to do is buy enough time to get lethal on them.
Right.
Because, let's face it, one way or another, if you get to turn six or seven, you're going to lose the game.
Right.
That's the story with that.
Basically, deck. Unless you rebuy Griffspoon, but basically you are. Now, the question is, how many threes do you want to play in your deck? That's also a big thing, because right now, you're just always going to have to play four copies of Always Watching, so then maybe you can fit two or three Thalia's into your deck and just see what happens.
Yeah.
But, I can see this being played either main or, especially as a sideboard card, too, to kind of slow down control decks.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Our final card, Unsubstantiate. One blue, one other, instant, return target spell or creature to its owner's hand.
Remand.
You don't get to draw off this one though.
You don't. It's like a tempo card,
yeah.
Right? But it's got that little extra versatility, right? You can bounce a creature, which is huge.
Yeah.
So having access to that is pretty nice. Now, where is this going to find a home? I'm not sure.
I don't think it necessarily has one right now.
But once again, the blue devotion deck would have loved this card.
Oh
right?
Yeah.
Right?
Just, oh yeah, it would have been great.
Yeah.
No, it's a good card. Yeah. It's a matter of finding the home for the card.
Right.
You get Reflector Mages and Unsubstantiates. Nothing stays on the board. No spells get cast.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe there is just like a blue-white deck that has some of this. Mm-hmm. Reflector Mage, Dragon Lord Ridge Tie, I don't know. And then you play some creatures and you just hold counters forever and get people.
And get them, yeah.
Right, because right now there aren't that many good playable counters. There's just none.
There are.
Silumgar Scorn if you want to be mono blue. People are playing Spell Shrivel, all right? That's where we're at with counter spells now.
Well, the way you say there's not that many good counterspells. I'm there aren't any good. There's literally zero good counterspells in
exactly.
standard right now.
So with this card, it's a little versatile. I mean, you just play some creatures and you just hold this up and it's Venser. Mm-hmm.
It's nice. It's nice because it's kind of a catch-all. It's kind of an answer to whatever comes at you. But it doesn't really answer. It just buys you time. It's a speed bump. It's a speed bump for everything.
Yeah, but it's just, once again, it's a fair card that is also a tempo card, but sometimes you're playing a creature deck and you just need that one extra turn, but you can't really main deck a card like Negate. But this card is just going to be playable in a lot of different matchups.
Yeah.
So,
I like the card. So I know there's many, many other Eldritch Moon cards we could talk about, and throughout the coming weeks leading up to the release, we will talk about more and more of them as they get previewed. But for this week, that's our list of Eldritch Moon cards we'll talk about, and that's our Magic TV. That leaves us with this week's Top 8.